called
from Marianne?
From Benicia poems.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll bring my clipboard when I come back.
Sure.
Because
I have a book check.
No, you don't need it.
Okay, good.
I love that. That's really good.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's really nice.
That's a beautiful. All right.
Hi, Lois.
I'm really excited.
I'm so happy you have an official title.
I'm going to be on that one.
Beautiful.
This is my daughter.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Florence.
These are grandchildren. Wow, nice to meet you.
Melissa.
Olivia. Oh, yes.
Olivia.
Olivia, nice to meet you. And you must be the responsible party.
Yes. This is Ronna Leon.
I was a poet laureate before Lois.
We took many walks in the streets of New York.
You should. Do you want help? Where would you like to go?
Can you take that, Mr. Hill? It's not for Hill.
And you come all the way from...
It is a hard part about me.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. My name is Ronna Leon. I'm the old poet laureate. But there are a few other old poet laureates in the audience emeritus. There's Joel Fallon. And I imagine that Robert Shelby will turn up as well. So we're here to support Lois, of course, and to get to hear her wonderful poetry, as I'm sure you are. But she asked me to first thank a few people who made this whole event possible. So she'd like to thank the American Association of University Women, and especially Julia Contestable, the Benicia League of Women Voters, and Susan Street, and Benicia Literary Arts. And I'm also supposed to be introducing Josanna Burkow. Josanna, are you here?
I'm here.
All right. Josanna would like to say a few words to you about Benicia's literary arts. Thank you.
This is the first time I've ever had to go down to a microphone. Welcome, everybody, and we're going to start honoring our wonderful new poet laureate in just a moment here. Lois kindly gave me the opportunity to tell you about this new nonprofit. We're the new kid in town. Everyone knows about the American Association of University Women. Everyone knows about the League of Women Voters. But the Benicia Literary Arts Guild is new. And I want to invite all of you to learn a little more about us and some of the events that we're doing. We're a nonprofit that's devoted to bringing literature in all forms, poetry, prose, and the like, to Benicia. We have just gotten started, and we have, this morning in fact, produced our first master class that was done by David Corbett, a local crime fiction writer that some of you may be familiar with at the bookshop, Benicia. Our second event that I wanted to make sure you knew about is this Thursday night. You can tape record that pesky vice presidential debate and show up, please, 7 to 9 at the new Benicia Bookshop location on First Street. We have three local writers, authors, because they are all published, who are going to be there to do some readings for you. David Corbett, who I mentioned earlier, Stephen Boyette, who is here in our audience this morning, and Janelle Moon. I have more information about this event. It's called Straight Quake, which is a relative of the more famous, perhaps, San Francisco Lit Quake. And I think Stephen can give you some more information at some break if you need it, or I can. And I have some flyers for you back on the table there, so you'll remember the time and place. So, again, thank you, Lois, for letting me let everyone know about the Benicia Literary Arts Group. We are called BEN, Lit for short, not blah, please. And please welcome, give us a look at, on our website, which is thebenicialiteraryarts.org. You can see it there and see some of the events at the Relic that we've posted in the past. Peter Gray is here. He was one of our readers there. And we will continue to bring you the literature of Benicia. That's our purpose of both publishing and events. So please keep us in mind. Keep us posted. And we hope to see all of you soon. Thank you. This is the first time I've ever had to go down to a microphone. We're going to start honoring our wonderful new poet laureate in just a moment here. Lois kindly gave me the opportunity to tell you about this new nonprofit. We're the new kid in town. Everyone knows about the American Association of University Women. Everyone knows about the League of Women Voters. But the Benicia Literary Arts Guild is new. And I want to invite all of you to learn a little more about us and some of the events that we're doing. We're a nonprofit that's devoted to bringing literature in all forms, poetry, prose, and the like, to Benicia. We have just gotten started, and we have, this morning, in fact, produced our first master class that was done by David Corbett, a local crime fiction writer that some of you may be familiar with at the bookshop, Benicia. Our second event that I wanted to make sure you knew about is this Thursday night. You can tape record that pesky vice presidential debate and show up, please, 7 to 9 at the new Benicia Bookshop location on First Street. We have three local writers, authors, because they are all published, who are going to be there to do some readings for you. David Corbett, who I mentioned earlier, Stephen Boyette, who is here in our audience this morning, and Janelle Moon. I have more information about this event. It's called Straight Quake, which is a relative of the more famous, perhaps, San Francisco Lit Quake. And I think Stephen can give you some more information at some break if you need it, or I can. And I have some flyers for you back on the table there, so you'll remember the time and place. So, again, thank you, Lois, for letting me let everyone know about the Benicia Literary Arts Group. We are called BEN. Lit for short, not blah, please. And please welcome, give us a look at, on our website, which is thebenicialiteraryarts.org. You can see it there and see some of the events at the Relic that we've posted in the past. Peter Gray is here. He was one of our readers there. And we will continue to bring you the literature of Benicia. That's our purpose. Of both publishing and events. So please keep us in mind, keep us posted, and we hope to see all of you soon. Thank you.
I like the sitting down. I feel very close and intimate. It's nice. So thank you very much, Josanna, for that information. And my next point is to tell you about First Tuesday's Poets. One of the reasons that we have a poet laureate is that our good friend Joel Fallon, a long time ago already, started a group of poets that meets on the first Tuesday of every month here in this room. And we hope that you will join us from 6:30 until 9. We read poetry together, either our own or poems that we like. And that will happen again next month. So please put it on your calendar and come to Benicia First Tuesday Poetry Group. We, of course, have a website also, and you can look up the activities. And you'll notice that there are a few activities that are coming up for Lois as well. She's going to be teaching a poetry class here in this room also on the 15th from 7 to 8:30. It's for both poets and non-poets. If you want to understand a little bit more about poetry, that's a real opportunity. Also, the poets are going to be reading on the art walk, and you'll see the three locales on the board. Please come and listen to some poetry at the art walk. It's a lot of fun. The galleries are all open as well, and you can have the chance to see Benicia artists and Benicia poets together. So the next thing that I would like to tell you, which is a treat for me, is Lois would like me to express her appreciation to the many family and friends who come from out of town for today's event, especially her son, Tony, and wife, Carrie. Would you stand up so everyone can see you? It would be very nice. Thank you very much. And her granddaughters, Melissa, Olivia, and Lauren. And her son, Phil, and his friend, Amity. Would you stand up? Thank you. And Lois is going to tell you about her family, so it's good that they're on the front row, right? So when they start to blush, it'll be, you know, it'll be good. And she'd also like to acknowledge some people who helped her get this event together. Stephen Boyer supported and tutored her for this event. I got to hear one of her rehearsals for the event, so I know that she's worked very hard to prepare her material for you. Sue Johnson, the owner of Sue Johnson's Lamps in Berkeley, and Lindsay Glass, lent them the lamp that's on display here. And Tom Stanton is running our sound system, which is somewhere. He's back in the back there. And J.D. Montgomery handled all the logistics for today. So let's give them a hand. We're almost at the place where Lois gets to read. Really. She says, though, that she wants you to know what's going to happen. And this is what's going to happen. At 3:45, we're going to have a 15-minute break for refreshments and socializing. You'll be cued to return to your seats when you hear flute being played by Melissa. So that'll be very much of a treat.
And Lois will read for about another half hour after that. And then we get to have a chance to ask Lois some questions and see what answers she has for us. So be thinking about that as you listen to her read. I know you're going to enjoy it. We'll be finished by 5 o'clock. At the back of the table during the break, there are some free poetry books by various members that you're welcome to take. Anybody who would like those or is welcome to take them. And please help yourself to those. And we'd also like you to look at some of the publications of Lois's work. These are not for sale, but if you'd like to see a little bit of the work that she's going to be talking about and reading from, they're here on this table. Now, all you have to do is make sure that your cell phones are off. I'll wait. Now, for the next 2 years, you're going to be enjoying the leadership of Lois as Poet Laureate of Benicia. And this reading is one of her official duties for the city of Benicia. It's also our chance to get to hear her poetry and learn a lot more about her personally. So I really look forward to this opportunity for all of us. I know you're going to have a wonderful time. She's a wonderful poet, and I'd like you to now welcome Lois.
Ask a question before I start. Is everybody comfortable with the temperature?
Too hot. We can't open the doors because there's an art exhibit out in the hall that has sound effects with it. Nobody that's in the library today knows how to turn the sound effects on. So I close that door, and to go out, we'll use this back door. I'll go find out about the temperature.
So I've never made a living as a writer, but I have made a life, one that makes sense to me. Writing is a craft that I practice, edit, revise, never get it perfect, but it's stimulating and it helps me understand myself and the world. The poet Marianne Moore wrote about poetry. I too dislike it. There are things that are important beyond all this fiddle. Reading it, however, with a perfect contempt for it, one discovers, after all, a place for the genuine. Hands that can grasp, eyes that can dilate, hair that can rise if it must. These things are important, not because a high-sounding interpretation can be put upon them, but because they are useful. When they become so derivative as to be... I looked at my son and that threw me off. When they become so derivative as to become unintelligible, the same thing may be said for all of us, that we do not admire what we cannot understand. The bat holding on upside down or in quest of something to eat, elephants pushing, a wild horse taking a roll, a tireless wolf under a tree, the immovable critic twitching his skin like a horse that feels a flea, the baseball fan, the statistician, nor is it valid to discriminate against business documents and school books. All these phenomena are important. One must make a distinction, however, when dragged into prominence by half-poets. The result is not poetry. Nor shall the poets among us can be literalists of the imagination, above insolence and triviality, and can present for inspection imaginary gardens with real toads in them, shall we have it? In the meantime, if you demand on the one hand the raw material of poetry in all its rawness, and that which is on the other hand genuine, you are interested in poetry. So do you remember Ted Baxter on the Mary Tyler Moore show. He always used to say, it all began in a 5,000-watt radio station in Fresno, California. Well, this isn't really that, but when I learned that it was one of my responsibilities to have a reading as Poet Laureate, I decided that I would like to share some of my work and give it some context and background. I grew up in the Boise Valley of Idaho on a farm. I was one of five children. We had a potbelly stove that heated the house to the extent it was heated, a telephone line that was shared with, by eight families, and an outhouse. I grew up with two black walnut trees, one for leaping from chicken coop roof through the air to swinging branch to powdery dust floating up like sifted flour, one for hiding sounds in the air of screen and cargo, voices slamming, the angry crunch of gravel. Out by the back porch, we tore the green husks away, cracked the hard shells for the tiny, tasty nuts, our fingers turning black under the nails. I never eat black walnut anything without remembering our mid-air leaps, stained fingers, and one was for hiding. As a child, our family went to two Protestant churches. The first one promised final destinations of heaven, which was tough to get into, and hell, which was easy to get into and impossible to get out. The second church that we went to, and I went to that church till I was 12, the second church believed in heaven on earth and no hell. Considering the options, I preferred the second one. My father was born in 1884. He was 24 years older than my mother. He had written on the inside of his Bible, children should be seen and not heard, and spare the rod, spoil the child. He died when I was a senior in high school. When the call came saying, you have died, I was washing my hair. I paused, rinsed it again. Finally, the dead standing tree, fallen, leafless as stone, hollow as an O, finished with the wind's howl, famished by the dust, by the sun, dry as paper. A child running toward you saw a trunk, branches for climbing toward others, hiding places, lookouts, she jumped into your emptiness. My mother, on the other hand, was reasonable, sensible, fair, and kind. She was the saving grace of my childhood. There was a lilac bush in our front yard, big enough for hide and seek. I thought about it Friday morning, cleaning house. Mother's favorite color is lavender, and she always talked about that bush. She harvested sugar beets in the chilly Idaho November and celebrated the next month by throwing a Christmas tree at the lot on 2nd Street next to a warm coffee shop. Then lilac blossoms float around my face, the irrigation ditch concaves in my palm, thirsty grass growing along its banks. The flowers came and went quickly each spring. A cold snap and they were just gone. Clusters, cone-shaped, tiny blooms with the fragrance, which in dreams she still carries into my room. Later, I remembered a character from my childhood, the Diteh Rider. In 1946, Idaho's Boise Valley hummed with growth. As a curious seven-year-old, I loved to climb the cottonwood trees alongside our house to stare across the vast field, land of fields and farms. The air was abuzz with insects. Near each farmhouse was a barn, sometimes a granary, a chicken house, a stack of hay, a tractor with a plow attached. The smell of hay and manure mixed with dust from the dirt road in front of our house. About 6 o'clock each morning and evening, farmers guided cows into barns for feeding and milking, pouring buckets of the white liquid through a strainer into the cans that would go to the creamery. By nature, this land is a desert, but huge irrigation projects have changed it. Every spring, starting about mid-April, the control wheels at Arrow Rock and Lucky Peak Dam begin letting out the water that floods and feeds the land. It flows from the Boise River into various canals through ever smaller channels to reach each farm. With the water came the Diteh Rider. I never knew his name, but when my mother mentioned spotting his presence, she did so in a soft, quiet way, and her face was solemn. No matter the technology of the system, it also depended upon humans. Each farm had assigned watering times, which, if violated, caused disruption. If a farmer went to irrigate and found that there was no water or very little, a search for the water began. The Diteh Rider was needed. In his watery domain, the Diteh Rider hovered at the edge of our lives, never quite belonging, always in charge. Because he was seen in only one way, he took on larger-than-life proportions. Shortly after his arrival, the brown earth turned green and yellow, trees and flowers came to life, the lilac bush blossomed, and the peony buds swelled. All day the Diteh Rider drove dirt roads, looking at and beyond us. The blue of his eyes was part of the landscape. The sun seared his skin. I thought that the sky and the land must be imprinted on his mind. His job was to keep the water flowing. In the 100-degree weather of summer, a few hours or days without water and the burgeoning life would begin to shrivel. He probably spent many hours shoveling mud out of culverts and cursing the dirt that forever flew in his face, but I never saw him that way. When he stopped to talk to a tractor driver or in front of one of the houses along our road, everyone quit what they were doing and watched as he picked a stalk of long grass, tore off the outer leaves, and began chewing it. He didn't say much, but even the surliest and most independent farmer listened to his words. Once the crops were harvested, the water was turned off. Yellow, orange, and red leaves fell all over the yard, and the Diteh Rider drove away in his pickup truck, one arm resting where the glass would be if it were rolled up. It never was. And there was a special school day that I wrote about in Whistle Stop. We talked about it for days before and after. Now, I have to concede, not a lot happened in our little Idaho town. If the noon PFE whistle went off at 12:05, that kept people going for a week. You take your excitement where you can get it. Our third grade teacher, Mrs. Allen, told us what was to happen. She would line us up 2 by 2 at 10 sharp. If you hadn't already gone to the bathroom and cleared your desk, you would stay behind in a room where you were not allowed to speak, but would sit reading with others who had somehow failed. That morning, I got up as if it were any other day and put on the thick brown stockings I was told to wear, not for warmth, but for modesty's sake, and a blue flowered dress made from a feed sack. Mother braided my long brown hair so tight it hurt beyond my ears. At 7:45, I went outside to catch the school bus that drove us to town. All the kids were kind of excited. Those who were always loud were a little louder. Those who were always scared of getting in trouble were unusually nervous. Mrs. Allen recognized the mood. She gave us an easy assignment and now allowed us to talk quietly with the students in front of or in back of us. I remember watching the clock on the wall, looking up every 10 minutes or so to find it had only moved 1 minute. I'd probably get in trouble and miss the whole thing. At 5 minutes to ten, Mrs. Allen told us to put our books away and line up. We followed her out of the room, through the wide hall with its enormous ceilings, and down the front steps of Lakeview School, where all the classes were lining up the way we did for a fire drill. At exactly 5 minutes after ten, Mr. Biddleston, the principal, ordered us to march, and we did. We walked the half dozen blocks to the train station, past vacant front porches that would later bear the retelling of today's event in precious detail. It was early October, and the yellow leaf trees seemed part of the parade. I thought we'd never get there. I can't say for sure, but everybody in town appeared to be there. Afterwards, everyone said they were. Barbara had taken time off from harvesting the season's last cutting of hay to come to town with their wives. It was arranged pretty well. I could see everything. The train was due at 10:30, and about that time we heard a whistle. Everyone started talking, craning their necks, pointing when the engine came in sight. It seemed as if the train was just going to go right on through, but it didn't. It stopped so the caboose was in full view of the crowd. Red, white, and blue bunting decorated the little platform at the rear. A band briefly played a Sousa march. The mayor came out first, looking as important as he ever would. He was followed by a man you might not have noticed if you passed him on the street, but that wasn't going to happen. Balding, not very tall, a gray-brown suit, he was followed by a woman who looked very much like my mother. I don't remember what he said. I know he used his arms as much as his mouth, and the crowd responded, cheering and clapping. He introduced his wife, Bess, and the crowd loved it. He took the town in 5 minutes, continuing to wave as the train pulled away toward Caldwell. For months after, you could feel the ripple when people spoke of the visit. Harry Truman became the only president we had ever known. Poet Charles Wright has said about childhood, shrunken and drained dry, turning transparent, you followed me like a dog I see through at last, a window into away from here, a place I'm headed for, my tongue loosened, tracks apparent, your beggar's lice reaching to crystal along my breeches leg. I'm going away now, goodbye. Goodbye to the locust husk and the chairs. Goodbye to the genuflections. Goodbye to the clothes that circle beneath the earth. The names falling into the darkness, face after face, like beads from the broken rosary. It actually amuses me to be able to sum up my childhood in 15 minutes. When I left home, I moved to Boise. I started working for the telephone company, took classes at what was then Boise Junior College. In my 20s, I met and married Tom Requist, had a son, moved to California, had another son. All of these were very, very big and important events in my life. Becoming a parent, you create a lifelong visceral bond. I feel what happens to them in my gut. As a young mother, I listened to talk radio. I listened to the news and talk radio, which was quite a bit different than it is now. I was very aware of the issues swirling in the country, the protests of the war in Vietnam, civil rights issues, women's liberation, the sexual revolution. While I changed diapers and took care of my family, there was a kind of a changing process going on within me. I thought about the role of women in society and my own place in particular. My husband was climbing the corporate ladder, and I thought his life was a lot more interesting and exciting than mine. I said this to him one time, and he said, he looked surprised, and he said, all I do is make money. You're raising children. Well, I appreciated what he said, but my own experience was that the role of a homemaker was paid lip service by the society, but not really a high value put upon it. This is a snowflower. I think it's called that because it appears in the woods just about the time that the old snow goes away. And I've used it as an image in what was one of my first feminist poems. I am living in another woman's body. Everyone likes her. She picks up after them, crawling into the split flesh of their wounds so the sting is hers. She smiles, says a few words, handle her gently. Her man-made body breaks easily. Lately, she has stopped comparing recipes, ignores Heloise, the fashion page. Her PTA membership is in arrears. Do not think this behavior, the elephant seal molting on the beach for 20 days, is ugly and repulsive going through the change. When I emerge, uncondemned by birth or sex, carrying trustworthy instincts, I am the flower that blooms as old snow disappears. Stark, red in a brown, blue, and green wood, with no apparent roots or protective coloring. The air around in every direction, purple and pink. When I was questioning many of the things that I had been taught, I wasn't alone. It was an age of question authority. I remember particularly reading C.S. Lewis, watching the Joseph Campbell series on the power of myth, reading several feminist writers, particularly Virginia Woolf and Adrienne Rich. The questioning caused me a good deal of angst. We returned to Idaho each summer, and I would challenge my brothers and sister. And then often when we came back, I was in tears because of the emotional conflict. It's a difficult thing to separate from your family over something so basic as faith. In 1974, we moved from Southern California to north to and settled in Milwaukee. Well, the kids were in school, I started taking classes at Diablo Valley College, getting the credits that I needed so that I could go to San Francisco State to seek a degree in English with the emphasis on creative writing. And soon after I got there, I had to select the genre to specialize in. And because I was both a student and a homemaker, had lots to do, I thought, well, I'll choose poetry. It's short. How much time can it take? I learned. The Housewife Poet. The housewife hunts for images between the bed sheets, imprint of bodies coming together apart, the mattress etched with habit. Her head spelling dreams, the white loaf reaches everything. Every dish carries the memory of the taste buds, the brown and white set from her mother-in-law. Her aunt wore sinks out with scrubbing. No one's pumpkin pie will ever be as good as recipes. Emily Dickinson fought her way in. Double fudge brownies. Bake, don't eat. Forgive me, pound, for images mundane. Marianne Moore might not have written about marriage if it had been reality. write what you know, a grocery list, one item per line, wax paper, toothpaste, words, walnuts. The poet has more discretion and less. What do you want? Where are the walnuts? The words, aisle 13B, in your hand, the other ones, the other, the other. I'm going to confess that I made a mistake already. When I talked about becoming a parent, I was supposed to read a poem, and I left it out, so here it is. My son, asleep, curled into the faded cotton, I fell in the street trying to unkink the garden hose before you were born. Did it hurt? What part of me did you take, clutched in your fist like lunch money along the birth canal? Did you resist waking then? Are you pulling me against you now for something we still share? You say, it's my dust. I collected it. Don't mess it up with your broom. You leave for school. I wander in your room for a sign, a fragment of connective tissue. Alien among tiny painted fighter planes on a nuclear ship, USS Enterprise, on your outgrown desk. Your soccer team running on the wall. Overhead from the sapphire blue ceiling, airplanes waiting for a flight plan. Well, so when I was taking poetry, it began to work its magic on me. And some words were transformative. They really stretched my thinking. The poet W.H. Auden wrote a poem in memory of Sigmund Freud, and I want to read just a few lines from that poem. In a world he changed simply by looking back with no false regrets. All that he did was to remember like the old and be honest like children. He wasn't clever at all. He merely told the unhappy present to recite the past like a poetry lesson, till sooner or later it faltered at the lines where long ago the accusations had begun, and suddenly knew by whom it had been judged, how rich life had been and how silly, and was life forgiven and more humble. Able to approach the future as a friend, without a wardrobe of excuses, without a set mask of rectitude or an embarrassing, overfamiliar gesture. While we studied poetry in poetic form, wrote sonnets and sestinas, most of what we wrote was free verse, though it was freer than that. When I went back to look at the instructors that I had at San Francisco State and looked at their poetry books, I saw that much of it looked like prose. I had an instructor, Nanos Valeritis, who was a Greek surrealist poet, and he encouraged experimentation, and he had quite an influence on my work. To go to class, I wrote BART, and I spent quite a bit of time on BART. And I thought about that odd connection and disconnection I felt with my fellow travelers. When I read this poem, you may notice some surrealist images. After seven, the personality changes. The night comes in, takes every third seat. Across from me, Barbie in red, white, and blue reads a Harlequin novel. Over her head, a woman is screaming. Is the train always so loud? Where are the police when you need them? What am I to do? She searches among the chronicles and sleepers for something to hold on to. She takes my eyes and will not let go. I nod, while Barbie's eyes snap sharp and open every 20 seconds. The woman hands me her despair in a plastic bag. I recognize it as my own. My eyes drop and roll down the track with the beautiful poems from my lap. This is the evidence used against me in court. For the defense, I have children, someone to meet me at 7:30. What am I to do? At 19th Street, she takes her diet soda and leaves. I expect relief, but my right hip has turned to stone and her tense jaw is carved there. I can cover it up. I can still make love, only slower. The business suits pick up their neckties, the chronicles fold into themselves, the words moving into place for tomorrow's edition. After I read one more piece, we will take a break. A 15-minute break, and there are refreshments at the back. When you hear the sounds of the flute, that will be your signal to take your seat again. That will be my granddaughter Melissa playing Haydn's Serenade. You may notice in some of my work that the process is in the product. And that is true in this one. In fact, this is a poetic essay, and I wrote it when I was in school, and I read it to my fellow students. It begins with a reason for writing by Theodore Spencer. No word that is not flesh, he said, can hold my wavering ear. But when that golden physical flesh is clear, I dance in a glory like your glory, with force to stir the dead. On becoming a poet / creative writer. Let's get one thing clear. It isn't voluntary. Words start growing between your teeth, like peach, flesh, fleas, fangs, and Pinocchio. It costs a lot to go to the movies now. Cheaper to stay home and eat strawberries. Peaches aren't in season in May. You floss, but the words don't come out. Flesh came out and is dangling, stringy, and despondent, looking for some fleshy flesh or an adjective. You go to the dentist. He's never seen a case like yours before. Pay $50 at the front desk. Become a poet / creative writer. That night in bed, you dream. Something weird grows from your left forefinger. It's a texture like velvet. Only it is alfalfa sprouting and it covers your hand. If it continues, you will never have to buy sprouts at the market. But you may have to keep your hand moist. Your analysis of the dream is that something inside is trying to grow. If you don't let it, it may turn malignant and fill your lower intestinal tract. Is this the process? What is the product? How do you become a poet / creative writer? You take some clay, but this clay is clay, not clay with which you sculpt, use a little water mold, something that will set 12 inches high on the coffee table, or even a little child comes into the room. At least people notice it. What can you do with clay? If you're a poet / creative writer, take the C, combine it with clutter and clusters of camellias and the acacia trees. Climb an oak, clean the air, clear the weeds, clamp down on military spending, cry for the spread of children. This is going nowhere. Where do you want to go? The Caribbean, Cairo, or Caldwell? Given the choice, who would choose Caldwell? Will this ever get 12 inches high on the coffee table? So right off, you must understand, as a poet / creative writer, you are working with reality once removed. Like a cousin once removed. If you want to work with reality, there's plenty of it. Out in my backyard, weeds, not W-E-E-D-S, are growing. The unoccupied space needs to be filled with annuals or tomatoes, not, well, you've got it by now. How do you feel about working with reality once removed? Understand the problem is perennial, like crabgrass or poison oak. It doesn't go away. You will always be striving to make the word flesh, the flesh word, the tomato on the page more pungent, redder than the one in the garden. You will be tempted to buy a camera. Does the camera tomato have juice? If you picture it squishy and touch it, will your hand turn red? How about becoming a gardener? Everyone will eat your tomatoes, cantaloupe, and zucchini. A friend will buy you the book on zucchini. They are prolific little devils. You will eat your words. It is easier to cultivate a friend who is a gardener than do the work yourself. And maybe your choice for life's work has something to do with clean fingernails and physical ambition. You will try uncanny combinations, and someone will always wonder why you don't do something cost-effective with your life. The condition may be congenital. You may have picked it up from a book or out of poetry reading. In any case, it's hard to get rid of. Understand the pitfalls. If you write wonderful stuff that your mother liked, no one else will. If you write wonderful stuff that other poets / creative writers like, your mother will wonder where she failed. If you write in the traditional forms of sonnets and sestinas, someone will snore at your reading. Some advanced poet / creative writer will tell you to be more adventuresome. As soon as you are, they will say, what are you doing that for? It doesn't make sense, has no recognizable pattern or syntax. You will think again about becoming a gardener. Reality once removed, or representation, or ideas, are your material. Is this as satisfying? For example, can you create a hot fudge sundae on the page in a chilled dish with two large scoops of vanilla ice cream, hot thick fudge, a maraschino cherry, nuts if you like, and real whipped cream, thus satisfying your appetite while not eating 700 calories? You begin to see the advantages, space, placement, and expense. You can put a cow, alfalfa, and a hot fudge sundae on the page together. The alfalfa will not disappear. It's less messy. You can bring things along with, into the scene that don't exist, you've never seen or couldn't afford. There is the problem of believability. However, the mind is more flexible than the body unless you work out regularly. The position may not be voluntary and is often unpaid, which may create strange bedfellows or feathers. Down is the best, use unless it gets wet, though WET doesn't cause any damage or a lack of plumpness. Being unpaid can result in that, or compromise, an odd lover who wants unheard of positions and foreplay. Now the words have become reality for you. Reality is once removed, an experience or the shape of a lamp that might work in a poem. The idea of down feathers, an antique lamp, or a coverlet passed from your grandmother may have possibilities more interesting on the page than in the room. Otherwise, you would be an interior decorator. You will dissect sentences, paragraphs, words, and lines. You will tear at your own flesh in the attempt to imprint your message somewhere with someone where it becomes flesh and dwells among us.
Thank you.
10 to sustain. I continue to write poetry, prose, fiction, nonfiction. I got very involved in the League of Women Voters, and I wrote a column for them for several years. I've written various freelance articles and columns pretty much since then. And so now, as many of you know, I write a weekly column for BeniciaPatch.com. And since it's October, I'm going to read a poem about a mind of October. I have gone out for honey, mushrooms, and plums. From my house, the still brown hills of California, the seasonless face of sky, and a mood is yet undetermined. From bank to fruit stand, trees changing costume for the new show. In the miles from carols to groceries, I reflect how seasons sit. People say they miss the seasons here. Is the musty smell, the subtle turning, more remembrance than real? Why do I always want to write about fall? The hallways of my mind are lined with its brilliance and decay, piled with pears that never ripen, and some that rot away. A sense unnamed moves through vein and artery. Going home, cold air surrounds me. Inside, the car is warm. I long to sleep in a quiet nest, to take pen and paper and hold on until the words are orange and fall naturally in the wind. We were living in suburban Moraga, and so the houses are fairly close together. Some of my neighbors I never saw. All I ever saw was their garage doors in a regular time of the day. And for some reason, that weird thing made me write about something called neighbors. And this is just an excerpt from a longer piece. There may be people there. I only know what I see. Who can say what is behind things? The regular rise and fall of the automatic garage door, turning off and on of electric lights, these are real. Stay with the face of things, I say. Keep out of trouble. Like morning coffee, that garage door picking itself up. I can't read the paper until it has opened and closed. When that electronic glow from the family room continues for hours, I give long lectures about the evil of television watching. He never listens. If there is a he, I want to stick with facts. He pushes his way onto my typewriter, mumbling something about immortality. His garage door is what I'm familiar with, the way it puts its face out there. He hides behind two sets of drapes. They're timeless as the moss creeping into his brick walk. The shears he never opens. The other set is impenetrable and can be held open with tiebacks. If he goes further into withdrawal, this set will fall, heavy and satin. I quit writing, take a shower. He comes in, says, call me George. George, no. I wrap into a towel and his fixation on G's, a familial relationship with E, O, and R. Then you'll have to be married. I haven't even thought about a wife. I'm sorry, Georges are always married. I don't make the rules here, George. You'll have to become more responsible. Middle management, 2.9 children. Never seen any kids up front. Put up a basketball hoop and we'll see what we can do. I had hoped to avoid children here. Not altogether, of course. One passes by now and then, lunch bucket in hand. People are more interesting without children, don't you think? They travel to Zanzibar, have exotic breakables in their living room. I have children, but they are semi-manageable at this point. I had a sort of escapism from motherhood. One feels so responsible if they turn out badly, as if a word here, a phrase, a pause in the right place might have made the difference. Oh,
16.
He has not left for work yet. Tuesday morning. What kind of a person stays in bed on Tuesday? I'm not allowing George to have children at this point. We'll talk about it later. It's easier to be neurotic than have children. That's what I wanted George to be, but the name is a handicap. What I started out with here was the regular electric currents that run through George's house, opening the garage door, turning lights on. That's all I know. Is he dead? Is the alarm buzzing to ears gone deaf forever? The mattress slumping under the new weight? Thank goodness he didn't have children. I couldn't bear it. I don't think he has a wife. I can't picture her waking up next to that unresponsive body,
you
screaming, running from room to room behind those implacable fears, pushing them back a bit, looking into the morning bland sky for a part of George that is missing. On the other hand, turning inward, thinking all of all the things he never fixed. Now she is, still formless, faceless behind the drapery pleats. She doesn't have a name yet, just George's wife or widow, as the case may be. I'm not convinced he's dead. But she interests me more. She doesn't garden. If she jogs, it's in another face. Nothing sweats behind those drapes. Lights don't flicker randomly. The garage door has a very steady pace. What does she do behind there? She has chosen to dedicate her life to keeping the house clean. She spends endless happy hours searching out dust, surrounding it, giving orders to the troops. Don't shoot till you see the whites of their eyes. On days she discovers a cobweb, although revolted at the thought of the enemy within, she is giddy with the chance for another conquest. After the battle, wiping the blood from her hands, she bellies up to the bar for a drink with the troops. It is 4 o'clock. She has time to take a bath, put on her mask, and simmer the onions. While I was delving deeply into the poetic world, my husband was, of course, the corporate man. Two very different worlds. One time I wanted to go into San Francisco for a poetry reading. We worked all day in the yard, got cleaned up, and went into a coffee house in the Cape Asbury district. Mm. Pretty soon Tom leaned over to me and said, "Why did we get cleaned up?" We should have a poem in the barrel contest. He watched with amusement as I sent poems out to poetry contests with a $5 or whatever entry fee, and he thought we should have a poem in the barrel contest. People would send in their poems with the entry fee. You separate the entry fee from the poem, put the poem in a barrel. When it's over, you pull out a poem, and that's the winner. Poetry contests often feel that random, and indeed, it is hard to judge poetry. I received my degrees around the same time that my kids were in high school or finishing high school. The day my son left for college, I'm going to have trouble reading this one. I left you writing notes on the internal failures of a computer. In the field, the ground cracks. Unplanned lines jag and curl on the path under the dry grass. The dog runs happily along. I'm going back now, sliding with you in the snow, loading a broken bike, fishing in Idaho, towns along the State River in a 50s scene. Irrigation water. Let's have all the kids line up over here. We drive hundreds of miles to reach California. Today you are leaving. Here in this field, I am alone. sharp stalks of grass, wind rustling, remnants of a plastic toy, a scrap of wood. Cars pass along the wrong road, a biker on the trail. He's you on the day of a century, running out of water, far from any town. The dog sniffs every possibility. He expects me to proceed or go home, not set watering this dry field. Your car head west, the basketball rolling with the curve. You are here, the grass becomes soft. Spring green blades caress my ankles. You are everywhere in all the sizes you've outgrown. I am there, putting the blood mark over the door. A bowl of soup. Snow, they say, may fall on Mount Diablo today. Conditions are right. My husband's elbow sticks out of an old sweater. We drink coffee, read today's tragedies. A coup d'etat in his lymph system strips him bare of immunity. Out the kitchen window, the sky turns pink. Mount Diablo waits whatever comes. At lunch, my friend and I cross the parking lot. A chilling wind whips our coats. The unseen gale cuts through trees, into flesh, face, and fingers. We clutch what we can hold on to. Conversation, a bowl of soup, potato leaf with crusts of brown bread. Lymphoma spills all over the table. Her husband, mine, illness and implications, an avalanche seeping through napkin and towel. Advised him to do whatever he really wanted to do, not to put anything off. He wanted me to see some of the places he had seen in Europe when he was stationed there. So we took several trips over there, and it greatly increased my interest in history and in the world beyond the United States. The last years of his life were challenging for him. He sometimes still showed his wicked sense of humor. When he was losing his hair due to chemotherapy, he put a sign on our front door that said, "Danger, falling hair." Tom died in May of 1994. I kept a journal of the years of his illness, and I've written that into a book called Taking Care of You and Me. I continued traveling, riding. I took several bicycle trips in Europe and in this country. In 2000, I moved to Benicia, which was a big change in my life. And I published my first novel, political and personal novel, Where Lilacs Bloom, which is available now on Amazon. It's available as an ebook. In 2005, I bought a small RV and went across the country for looking at the United States and Eastern Canada for about a year. And from the journal that I kept with that, I wrote RVing solo across America without a cat, dog, man, or gun. This is also, it was after that trip that I really got more involved in the community of Benicia, and I really feel more of a part of this community than any place I've lived. It was also the time when I have had the joy and the pleasure of three granddaughters. In 2009, my family, including the girls, hiked the Grand Canyon rim to rim to celebrate my 70th birthday. The amazing grace of this delicious morning, waking slowly, no immediate demand, granddaughters sharing a ubiquitous hotel room with grandmother, stir slowly, slumber, the peace of it still present. A little talk, something silly said, laughter ripples, a serious comment, surprisingly succinct replies. The girl's long, often tangled hair, languid on pillows, not ready yet for today's brushing. Restless fingers flick something electronic, a game, a message to someone, a sign of the times, their continuous partial attention. Four people, comfortable with each other, moving slowly toward the day, content in the moment, unrecognized until it's over, the amazing grace of it. And the scenes of Benicia have started to work their way into my poetry. A lot of it is not finished yet. But here is one that I wrote about something I hear a lot in the winter months here, foghorns. The long, low, lugubrious sound floating across the water wakes me from deep sleep. The guttural vibration felt more than heard. From the watery depths, the rumble reaches my cozy cocoon. Somewhere a ship says, I'm out here alone, let's not get too close. Eyes close, mind in repose, the sound stirs a low belly response. I want to give it a word. Why do I want to give it a word? That's what poets do. Seeking to capture, hold, define those skitterings at the intersection of spirit, mind, and emotion. We are out there on the edge, skating on thin ice, trying to give shape, image, language to what is just beyond, in the haze of morning sound, the unconscious foghorn of the mind. Mm-hmm. A couple of years ago, Ronna Leon pulled together and created a show. I read the news today, oh boy. And I teamed with a young artist from San Francisco. And this is her artwork. And then I wrote the poem that accompanies it. Now, I'm going to read. It's really a collage. You'll recognize some of the people speaking. And it begins with a quote from Dwight David Eisenhower. Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired, signifies in the final sense a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, from those who are cold and are not clothed. The cost of one modern heavy bomber is this, a modern brick school in more than 30 cities. We pay for a single fighter with a 500,000 bushels of wheat. We pay for a single destroyer with new homes that could have housed more than 8,000 people. The God of War. The devil, they told me in church, where hell was on offer as my future destination, is beguiling, seductive, the best salesman ever. The existence of looming national peril requires a new war. First, the machine must be fed. Every president, every senator, eerily sucked in. Even those who cry for peace, jobs and votes plead louder. Peace, the centuries-old desire. War, the oldest story. Wilfred Owens tells of World War I soldiers, bent, broken, barely alive. If you could hear at every jolt the blood gargling from the froth-corrupted lungs, my friend, you would not tell the high zest, two children ardent for some desperate glory, the old lie, it is sweet and right to die for your country. Bid fails to end Afghan conflict. Heartless, headless drones take human life without regret. In surprise, Boeing wins contract for tankers. The new bird that will flutter and fly in the sky. sleek, hard, fast, blue devils, really. If I go around again, I'd like to be a bird, with feathers, a beak, and a heart, soaring, turning, gliding, floating upward on draft, swooping down, observing the earth. The blue background becomes it. The bigger bird swallows the smaller. American soldiers in Iraq, Afghanistan, go into the jaws of death, the mouth of hell. The little one sleeps in its cradle. I lift the gauze and look a long time, and silently brush away flies with my hand. Protecting the children is the political stance. Our own heart, soul, mind, body, DNA protests, as all of us are swallowed by the mechanisms of war, our lives subservient to the God that will have none other before him. Finish the afternoon dreaming with a bike trip, a bike ride. One of the things I've always enjoyed about biking is that my mind can kind of just wander, and so it kind of does in this poem. You could call it a concrete poem because on a page it kind of looks what it looks like. to a part. That small fallacy in the heart has overtaken us. That tension which caused us to hold too tight. Guilt, caution, rules, and the children are no longer children. Ride with me as far as you can. Say my name so I will have one. Hold everything up to the light, the transparent light. Ride with me through the end, through the wind, to the end. There is no end, a circular path. The end is the beginning, is the end, but can I keep my name? It is the autumn of my life. Grass once green, now like golden, shiny stubble. Maple leaves line the section of the path, big as my palm. Dry edges curling. In late August, the smell of rotting fruit on the ground next to the trail alerts a poignant old memory. Everything ripens, everything decays. New children are going to school, thinking it will last forever. The light will fade, the wind will come, cold, inhospitable, sometimes wet. When I am gone, the bike trail will not look different. The seasons will continue. I would like to return in wind and cloud, swing through oak trees, go at that speed. You have transformed these words into something of your own, a life I never knew, a home with a hall through which I will never pass. My words will go where I cannot and will report my thoughts when they are no more. I will be my words' influence echoes.
Stand here and use my big voice and hope that you can all hear me. If you have a question for Lois, either about her poetry that you've heard this afternoon, her wonderful poetry, or about her plans for her poet laureatehood, I guess, here in Benicia, just raise your hand and I'll call upon you and we can do those questions and answers. Yes, Peter.
Do you have a singular favorite poem of your own?
No.
I'm not sure I do.
Yeah.
Do you have a few poets that you would heartily recommend to the group?
Well, yeah, I do. Of course, Emily Dickinson is, you know, pretty hard to beat. But Ape Adrian Edge, she's a favorite. And contemporary ones, he was just poet laureate. Who am I thinking of? Billy Collins. And Sharon Olds. And Auden, I studied him. He's very good. There's so many.
So do you start with the word, or the image, or a feeling? What's the genesis of
that? Well, probably the feeling. Although I think when I started writing poetry, I probably started with the words more. And I know there's a lot of people who use prompts, and sometimes the prompts can help. But I think now it probably starts with a feeling.
Yes.
Lois, what are some of your plans as poet laureate? What do you hope to accomplish?
Well, I'm following this lady. If I could just sort of keep the path going. Excuse me. I know we're going to have a love poetry contest again. Met with Joel and Don Perry this week. We're going to have a poetry out loud contest again in the schools. It's a recitation program that is. If they win in Benicia, then they compete at the state level, and then it goes on to the national level. So it's a nice program, and we're going to do that again. I am particularly pleased that within the last month, some of us read at the Art Walk, and were really, really well received. It meant a lot to me because when people come in here, or they come to any poetry meeting, they're kind of making a commitment. You know, you kind of got to sit down here and listen, and you could get up and leave in the middle, but that we might not want to. But at the art walk, people wander out, they listen, they leave, they're not here, they come in. And I just felt we were really well received. And a lot of people came to the art walk and came and listened to us and really listened. So I'm really pleased at that, because I think it's nice when... I don't like poetry to have a stuffy...
And just look at that board. You have a chance to hear the quotes again at the art walk in three different locales. Yeah, another question from Peter Grimm.
Is the art walk going to continue into the spring, or is there any plan for it beyond December of this year?
I don't know.
We're having a meeting next week on Tuesday at 9:30 at the community center in room 1. Anybody who's interested in talking about the art walk and has any wonderful ideas about it is willing to, we'll welcome you to come. But yes, we probably will continue.
Thank you, Beth.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yes,
David. So you read a lot of work from the 70s, right? Some of the work that you read was from the 70s.
Right.
So how would you say your work has evolved, and or what's the difference between the role that poetry played in your life at that time and poetry plays in your life now?
Did everyone hear that question?
Yeah.
All right.
Well, I've actually written, I would say, in more recent years, more prose than poetry. And it's only been, like, probably since about 2006 that I've started writing more poetry again. And getting involved in this group has been good to do that with. So I try to write, but I want every piece to, everything, anything I write to take its own natural form. And so I keep looking at that.
I would like to ask about the publishing end of your poetry. Did you end up in a contest and it won a little thing and poetry book or somebody else's? Or did you write your own poetry book? And then how did you do that?
Well, it depends. Most of those things, I've published something in these books. Now, it isn't all poetry. Some of it's prose. This particular book, and these are free back there if you want, if there are some left, which several of the poems I read today are in. Actually, there were 5 poets from San Francisco State, and we went together and produced this. And Frances Mays, and some of you may recognize her name, wrote the introduction for this book. Well,
it's available where?
Well, actually, it's not available. I mean, I'll give it to you, but it's... Okay, Stephen, I really have to give... I cannot say enough. He tutored me before this, and he has just made... He just is so helpful. I really appreciate it a great deal. But he came up to me at the break and said, well, you should tell people where they can buy these things. Now, it's not, I mean, the books are for sale, but, you know, like they're at the local bookstore and at Amazon and various places. A lot of these things really are published in books that are not in print anymore. So there isn't a ready place that I can say.
I can say that Lois's work has appeared numerous times in the anthologies that the First Tuesday Poetry Group puts out, including our most recent one, which is called Sign of the Times, and that is also available on Amazon and represents other poets in the group as well.
So if we go to Bookstore Venetia, they have a selection of your writing.
They have Sign of the Times, and they have Arvine Solo. I'm not sure that they have Where Lilacs Bloom. I don't actually know if they have it right now.
But they can order it.
They can order it.
And you can
It's electronic.
Well, I'm going to go with
the workshop. Support the local.
Yeah, exactly. These are both.
Support your local books.
Support your local books.
You have to pay sales tax on Amazon now, folks. So I am Christine Mayo at Bookshop.
Are there any other questions before we conclude here that anyone would like to ask? Yes.
How old was your dad when he passed?
He was 72.
Powerful.
Thank you.
Oh, Peter has another question. He's just one of those guys in class.
As you know, there has to be a time during the day or night when you know it's not just a passing thought. You've got to scramble for paper.
Scramble for paper.
Yeah, you know this little thought in your head really needs to get on the paper. So do you have a notepad that you keep?
No. If it's that important, I'll remember it. Some people say put a pad of paper by your bed, but I'm a person who has trouble sleeping.
Well, I know we've all been inspired by Lois's poems. Thank you so much for coming this afternoon. Let's give her a hand.